My name is Cindy. I'm the director of MoMath. It's my pleasure to welcome a live audience back to Math Encounters. Woohoo! And also my pleasure to thank the Simons Foundation, who has been sponsoring this wonderful series for us for many years. I know many of you in the audience have been here before to Math Encounters, and you're glad to be back. And I know some of you, this might be your first time here, and you might have come across us online over the last year and some odd months. So thank you to everyone for being here. I hope if it is your first time here, it won't be your last time here. Without further ado, it's my pleasure to welcome someone who will kick off tonight's program, Janna Levin. She's the Claire Tau Professor of Physics and Astronomy from Barnard College at Columbia. And it is my pleasure to ask her to kick us off tonight. I will mention one thing. She's the author of an amazing book, which we sell in the shop here, How the Universe Got Its Spots. So if you like hearing from Janna, maybe you'll like her book too.
This is exciting. We all just survived a plague, so that happened, and here we are. I'm very delighted to introduce David Spergel, who is and always has been a superstar of really the highest order. He is a renowned cosmologist and astrophysicist. David has contributed to measurements of the age, shape, and composition of the universe. So, you know, small things like that, irrelevant things like that. He has used some of the most successful astronomical instruments, including the influential WMAP satellite. And it's worth mentioning that David was part of the original team that defined the mission and also really worked on establishing how the spacecraft would be built. So that's very significant. And that spacecraft has mapped archaeological records of the light left over from the Big Bang. It really provides details of the entire history of the cosmos. It's a remarkable thing. And one of the most influential contributions that David has made of his many influential contributions is understanding how to decode that map and understand what it says to us about the history of the cosmos. Some of those papers on that subject are the most cited papers in the history of the subject. I would say among the recent papers, they are number one and number two in the entire field, so very impactful. He's also very sought out for his leadership and his scientific vision, and it's not always that common that the person with that kind of gravitas is also in a leadership role. He's influenced so many astronomical projects, including searches for exoplanets and upcoming searches to study the atmospheres of nearby exoplanets in the search for life, for sentient life out there in the universe to understand if we're alone, including a leadership role as well in the Simons Observatory, which is an upcoming observatory of great significance, dark matter searches and dark energy searches. Essentially, David's breadth and influence are pretty legendary. I would say that paired with his world-class intellect is this kind of improbably affable personality as well. And I don't know how many people here in the live audience know David personally, but he really is just a great guy. And he's very spontaneous and fun and creative. Everyone who works closely with him describes specifically that creativity. I can't tell you how many of his closest collaborators have said to me, he is the most creative person I have ever worked with. And that is of huge significance in a scientific field. There's something that's always struck me as well about David, and that is this sort of high-spirited pleasure and joy he has when he's working. That's very contagious. He has this unbelievable sort of innate ability to go for a discovery, but it's always in this almost childlike, joyous way. I don't really hear him kind of opine with overwrought romanticism about the universe. It's always just having a great time and going for the discovery. He's worked on topics that are so esoteric and difficult, like cosmic streams or whether the universe is infinite or finite, very esoteric topics. But really, he's always had his eye on the big picture, the big brushstrokes. He always knows what's genuinely really important. He's just extremely open-minded. And I would say his savvy in recognizing where the next discovery is going to come is almost preternatural. I don't give long academic style introductions, which I know is kind of the norm at some of these things. I mean, I could cite his grades in middle school. Not that he's told me that, and move chronologically from there, but obviously he has an impressive academic record. He was an undergraduate at Princeton and was a visiting scholar at Oxford and went on to get a PhD at Harvard. And we all know that David has this long legacy, but I don't really believe that those are the things that define or that we need to cite to describe his intellectual heft. I think that has been proven in his research, which is really much more meaningful. He has won essentially every major prize in the field, beginning with the early years when people are searching for great new talent, things like the Sloan Fellowship and the MacArthur Prize. He goes on in his career to win the Breakthrough Prize in Theoretical Physics, the Gruber Prize with the WMAP team, the Shaw Astronomy Prize. There's about 12 other incredibly significant prizes that could be listed. And if none of these mean anything to you, I think it's fair to say that essentially David has earned very nearly every accolade awarded in our field. To my mind, one of his most exceptional qualities is that he absolutely recognizes without hesitation what is interesting and important. He comprehends in what I call big brush strokes what's worth pursuing, but also in small brush strokes, how to calculate, how to do the hard stuff, how to find the math, how to follow the chalk. And after 3 decades at Princeton, he is still professor emeritus after leaving Princeton to become the founding director of the Center for Computational Astrophysics at the Flatiron Institute. And as we were discussing tonight, he is in his 4th day as the new president of the Simons Foundation, which I have to say is unparalleled in science philanthropy. He has many glamorous appearances in top lists of what I call X and Y, you know, the top 10 of most influential scientists in time. I mean, for me, most importantly, which I would like David to put in his CV, is that he is one of my top 3 most influential astrophysicists in my life. And it is my great pleasure to introduce my friend, an inspiration, a brilliant creative spirit, and truly a force of nature, Professor David Spergel.
Thank you, Janna. Thanks so much for that generous introduction. And you know, this is an exciting sort of moment in my career, as Janna mentioned. This has just started my new job, and it's one of these transitions in life that I describe as akin to starting college as an undergraduate. First days as an assistant professor, just so much to learn and so much new to do. And the Simons Foundation is this wonderful organization to be part of, and one of the many wonderful institutions that we help support is MoMA. So it's a great pleasure to be here and to be here and to talk to people in person. I think many of us have been all of us have suffered in different ways in these past 15 months. We're all, I think, grateful for science through vaccination bringing us back. Want to say hello to those of people out in Zoom. It's terrific, you know, terrific that people can join now so easily from remote locations. It greatly enables us to increase our impact. On the other hand, nothing beats being there in person. And for those of you who can make it here to New York, you aren't watching from too far away, come visit. I can't think of a better time to come to New York. There's a tremendous energy out there. And so come back to the city and come back to MoMath. And those of you who've been able to join remotely over those past year or so, it's been great to see things continue here through COVID. Now's the time to do the thing in person. And having made it to Venice in late May before the crowds, nothing beats getting to touristed spots before anyone else does. So now's the time to come. Bill de Blasio asked me to say that. So, what I want to do today is really introduce three ideas. I want to first give you an introduction to cosmology. Then I want to talk about geometry. What is the geometry of the universe? And then I want to talk about topology. And one of the things I want to emphasize is geometry and topology are actually telling us different things about the structure of the universe and are linked to different properties. And we'll talk about what both mean and what we know about the geometry of the universe and topology of the universe. In order to introduce cosmology, I'm going to have to start by teaching relativity. Start with special relativity. The key idea in special relativity for us is light travels at a finite speed. Takes light about a few billionths of a second to get from me to you in the audience, a little bit longer because it has to travel through the internet to those watching online. But those people sitting in the front row aren't seeing me as I am now, but as I was a billionth of a second ago. I don't change that much in a billionth of a second, so it's not a big deal. The further out we look, the further out back you go in time. We see the sun as it was 8 minutes ago. We see Mars, or maybe as it was about half an hour ago. There's that wonderful scene communicating with Mars, right, where you have to wait for the signal to come back. And then you go out to the nearest stars. Nearest stars are 4 light years away. What does that mean? It takes light 4 years to get there. So we see them as they were 4 years ago. And it's symmetric. If you were sitting in a spacecraft around Alpha Centauri, you would see us 4 years ago. Further out you go in space, the further back we see in time. We see the Andromeda galaxy, the nearest big galaxy, as it was 1 million years ago. Someone, or some creature sitting in the Andromeda galaxy with an incredibly powerful telescope staring at Earth would see the emergence of early humans 1 million years ago. And the further back we go in space, the further back we go in time. And we will go out to look at the microwave background, the leftover heat from the Big Bang, and we will see the universe as it was about 13.7 billion years ago. Good. Everyone's good with special relativity? Excellent. Now we're going to move on to general relativity. The key idea in general relativity, and this goes back, this statement of it goes back to my academic great-grandfather, Johnny Wheeler. Matter tells space how to curve. So here's the sun curving space around it. And the curvature of space tells matter and light how to move. So here is the first test of general relativity. This star, which was at position A, as the light travels to us, it gets deflected. So sitting on Earth, we observe it at position B. Now to see this in 1919 was hard because you had to observe the bright sun. So you waited to the solar eclipse. And during the solar eclipse, this was the great test of Einstein's theory of relativity. Here's the New York Times from November 10th, 1919, reporting lights all askew in the heavens. Here's some New York Times fake news. Stars were not where they seemed or were calculated to be, but no one need worry. They were exactly where Einstein calculated them to be. So, you know, Einstein got this right. And, that was the first test of relativity, general relativity. So now we have this link between how much mass is there and how space curves. Once we start with general relativity as our theory to describe the universe, what general relativity tells us is the universe as a whole must be expanding or contracting. Now, I think this is the most difficult conceptual idea here, is to think about what does it mean for the universe to expand. The way I like to think about it is to think about, for the moment, only a two-dimensional universe, either the surface of a plane or the surface of a sphere. And let's think about a sphere for a moment. And when I think about the universe expanding, it's the distance between galaxies are growing, but I think of the universe expanding into the future. So as we go from here in time to here, the distances between galaxies grow as we go from a few billion years ago to today. So if we think about this sphere expanding out, getting less and less dense, we can run time backwards. We run times backwards, things get denser and denser, closer and closer together, so get hotter and hotter. Eventually they reach such an enormous density, everything collapses to a point in time. So there's a moment in time that occurs everywhere in space that we call the initial singularity. And in the Big Bang model, that's where the model begins. There's the fascinating question, which we do not know the answer to. What was there before there? Or did time begin here? Should we be thinking about the question of what was before the Big Bang as what's north of the North Pole? Or was there something before? We don't know. But for now, we'll just think about this expanding history, the universe getting denser and denser, hotter and hotter with time. And in that picture, we go back far enough, we get to such enormous temperatures that the universe is ionized. And all the photons, all the leftover heat from the Big Bang was interacting with the universe. So when we look back in time, back, we're looking out to a moment where we're looking at what the universe looked like back then. We're looking out 13.7 billion years, and we're seeing what the physical conditions were then. Now that's gonna be really useful. That's gonna be a key part of our story, because by mapping that leftover heat from the Big Bang, we're gonna learn about the geometry and topology of the universe. So as Janna already mentioned, one of the things I did was I was part of a team led by Chuck Bennett, who was at NASA Goddard, that built what we eventually called the Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe that went out and mapped the leftover heat from the Big Bang. And it made a map of the sky. And here's the map shown at one frequency of the whole sky. And it's a map of the sky. So it's the sphere around us. And this is what the map looks like actually at a higher frequency that you'll see in a moment. And what this bright red thing is our galaxy, the Milky Way. This is all nearby stuff in the red that's only about typically a few thousand light years away. It's close. You know, this is like looking out as a cosmologist at a beautiful scene out your car window, but there's a smudge in the car window, and that smudge is the dust from the galaxy. And it's really right in your face. And we want to study this stuff, which is light that's been traveling to us for 13.7 billion years. So what we do is we map the sky at multiple frequencies, and we see the dust emits different amounts at different frequencies. Here's our highest frequency that corresponds to the sphere. And by taking our multi-frequency data, we can combine that, zoomed in, and make a map of the whole galaxy, the whole sky corrected. So this is a map really of the universe's baby picture. We've now removed the contribution from the galaxy, and we're looking at a pattern of fluctuations that reflect physical conditions 13.7 billion years ago, only about 380,000 years after the Big Bang. And what you're seeing in this map are tiny variations in the temperature of the universe, variations at the level of a few millionths of a degree. So the from the brightest to the hottest spot on this map might be a 10,000th of a degree. So these are tiny ripples in the temperature of the universe that we detect with our experiments. And they reflect variations in density and temperature of the universe. So these are the tiny fluctuations that eventually grow to form galaxies. So what we do is this is how our universe is baby picture. We can study this and learn enormous about the universe. One of my favorite things that I first saw when we were looking at this, look carefully, there's a letters SH. That's either a complete coincidence and our brain's tendency to form patterns, or a memorialization of Stephen Hawking. Though actually, when I first saw this, it was during a talk at UC Davis on the implications of these results by Stephen Hawking, and it was over his head. And we actually thought, I was sitting next to my colleague, Lyman Page, who built a lot of the experiment with me. We thought this was put in by his students as a joke when we saw this on the big screen. We hadn't noticed it before. And we pulled up the raw data, which we had on our laptops, and it's indeed there in the raw data. And I think this is telling us more about our ability to find patterns. So that was the data we took in 2003. The data continues to improve. After our work back then, we integrated for about another 6 years, 2009, then the Europeans launched with a joint collaboration with NASA, but led by the European Space Agency, a follow-up satellite called Planck that mapped things at even higher resolution and higher sensitivity. And we're continuing to improve those measurements. These are measurements we take from Chile, from a telescope called the Atacama Cosmology Telescope. And you can see here's a portion of the sky zoomed in with the Planck data. And you can see from the ground in Chile on small scales, we can map things with much higher sensitivity. And one of the things that I'm involved with, and it's supported by the Simons Foundation, is we're building a new observatory in Chile called the Simons Observatory that will map things at more than 10 times the sensitivity of Planck, 40 times the sensitivity of what we see here with WMAP. So we continue, I'll show mostly some of the older data, but because the basic results have been in place for a while, but this is a subject where our observations continue to improve. So that's cosmology. The key ideas I want you to take away from that is when we look out the microwave background, we're looking at the universe's baby picture, we're seeing the physical conditions of what grew to form galaxies, and also we're seeing as we're looking out in space back in time, we're actually looking out at a surface 13.7 billion years in radius, light years in radius. So now let's turn to geometry. When we talk about geometry, we're talking about curvature. Now, most of you were taught probably in middle school, that the sum of the angles in a triangle is 180 degrees. And that's true on a flat piece of paper. But try drawing a triangle on the surface of a sphere. You do that, you'll find the sum of the angles are greater than 180 degrees, right? And you can imagine basically taking a journey, this was not our microwave background, but the globe, right, I take a journey from New York to Boston, all the way around to Moscow, and then back to New York. You look at that triangle, the sum of the angles, right, are going to be, you know, much bigger. And then the other, that's a positively curved surface, like the surface of a sphere. There's also negatively curved surfaces that look like this saddle. And we don't know, you know, the universe's geometry, according to general relativity, could be any of these things. These are all possible for you to form, we call homogeneous, the same everywhere, universes. Now, in general relativity, The geometry is determined by the density of the universe. Higher density, more curvature. So a dense universe is going to be positively curved, like the surface of the sphere. A low density universe is going to be negatively curved. And general relativity teaches us that geometry is destiny. You have a positively curved universe. It'll start, our Big Bang, start expanding, reach a maximum density, and turn around and end in a big crunch. A low density universe will expand forever, get ever colder, ever emptier and emptier. There's a famous poem by Robert Frost, and this poem was prompted by a conversation actually in the Harvard Faculty Club, where Harlow Shapley, one of the leading astronomers of the 1930s, 40s, 50s, that epoch, was talking to him, to Frost, about the then new theories of cosmology. The possibility that the universe can end in a hot big crunch or expand forever and have a cold death. So you may not know this poem about, some say the world will end in fire, others say in ice. And that poem is about the two cosmologies and the possible fates of our universe. And that's really tied mostly to our geometry. Now let's talk some more about geometry. Another way of measuring geometry besides drawing triangles is drawing circles. Let's take a flat piece of paper and draw circles on that flat paper. I'm sure you've all learned, and many of you may still remember, that the circumference of a circle is 2 pi times the radius. And as your circle radius gets bigger, circle gets bigger. That works in flat space. Then let's talk about spheres in flat space. If I draw a sphere in flat space, the surface area of the sphere gets bigger as the radius grows, and the area of the sphere grows as 4 pi radius squared. But now look and see what happens. Let's go back to positively curved space. What happens if I draw circles on a sphere? If I draw a circle right around the North Pole, the circumference is, since you're close enough to the North Pole, it's almost 2 pi r. It's a little bit smaller, but pretty close. But let's draw bigger circles, these bigger lines of latitude, and bigger circles. And as they eventually, I get to the equator, and that's as big as the circle gets. And then the circle starts getting smaller and smaller. My radius has gotten bigger, but my circle's gotten smaller. The circumference of my circle grows as the sine of the radius. It reaches some maximum size. And if I have positively curved space, the area grows initially seemingly like flat space, but eventually the area of my sphere reaches a maximum size and turns around. And these properties are things we can observe by looking at the flux I see from a star or something like things like that sort. The way we've been measuring these geometries is by looking at the patterns in the microwave sky. As I look out at the patterns that are generated will look different. They'll get stretched bigger in the closed universe and seem smaller in my negatively curved open universe. So by measuring the size of these hot and cold spots, we can measure the geometry of our universe. The characteristic size of those hot and cold spots is set by something we call the sonic horizon. That's just how far a sound wave can move in the 380,000 years. And what nature is doing for us is it's basically holding up a ruler in the sky that's about 380,000 light years across approximately. And that's set by how far the sound wave moves and that's the size of the hot and cold spots on the map. So what we do is we just measure them and then see, is the angle a degree like it's expected in a flat universe, or more like a third of a degree as you'd expect it to be in an open or negatively curved universe, or is it more than a degree as it would be in a positively curved universe? And so we take our map, and then what we do in practice is we stack up, we take each of these hot spots and we stack the temperature around it. And we add up all the data that way. And this gives us, see on this plot on top, that's stacked around every hot spot, we see a cold ring. Stacked around every hot spot, cold spot, we see a hot ring. And by measuring the angle here, it's now just really high school trigonometry. I know the length of this axis, I can measure the angle, and that tells me the geometry of the universe. And by measuring not just this angle, but the relative intensity of the cold spot and the hot ring, that actually tells me how much matter and how many atoms we have in the universe. Because this is dominated by atoms, electrons and protons and radiation. This is dominated by what we call cold dark matter. So we're actually able to measure the universe's composition in detail by looking at these measurements. And what's shown here is this is the pattern that's observed, and this is the pattern from our best fit model, and they match up beautifully. So we actually have a model that fits the basic data that is our basic cosmological model. So this is our model that's with five basic numbers, the density of atoms, its composition in terms of atoms, dark matter, dark energy, how lumpy the universe is and how it varies with scale. And with all of that, that fits our data. This shows the data that we had now almost about 15 years ago, and the data is only improved and the model continues to fit remarkably well. So that's the story about the universe's geometry, that its geometry seems to be close to flat. Now, the thing about flat, it's the limiting case between positive curvature and negative curvature. You've measured something as curvature is close to zero. And when it's close to zero, it still could be a little positively curved or a little negatively curved. And given our uncertainties in our measurements, we don't really know which way it goes. So it's still, we know it's close to flat, but we'd like to continue to improve that. The next question we'd like to answer, and to me, this is a really profound one, is the universe finite or infinite? If I, you know, keep going in one direction, will I come back to where I started? And this question about finite or infinite is really a question about the topology of the universe. So now let's talk about topology. So when I think about the topology of a surface, I can take this square here. I can glue one side to another to make a cylinder. And then I can glue this side to another, and I make a donut or a bagel, since this is New York. A funny story, which I don't know if Janna knows, this involves our friend Neil Cornish. Neil Cornish was a postdoc, worked with us on the topology of the universe, whether the universe was better described by a donut. And he was a postdoc working with Stephen Hawking at Cambridge. And the team who made The Simpsons came to Cambridge to talk to Hawking. And they talked to Neil, who was a very outgoing, personable Australian. And Neil explained, they asked him, what does he work on? He said, whether the universe is shaped like this or not. And they got all excited about this. And there is an episode of The Simpsons in which Homer Simpson explains to Stephen Hawking his donut theory of the universe. And This, though it didn't make Janna's introduction, I think is one of my greatest accomplishments, that our research influenced an episode of The Simpsons. When we look at this kind of universe here, if the universe was like this, it would be finite. You start here, you keep going, you come back to where you started. Or you can come back there and come back to where you started. Now, this is one representation of a finite universe. I also want you to think about this representation, because we're going to be easier to use this when we go to three dimensions. In this representation, which is the same, just an unglued version of this, if I go reach this edge, I reappear here. If I reach this edge, I reappear here. Same thing here. This is just another way of representing this donut. This is our fundamental domain. And yet another way of representing our donut is to represent it like this, where these are, in this case, 9 identical copies of the universe. So if I'm here, I'm also here, 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 here. And that's just a different way of visualizing it that we're going to want to make use of when we think about the universe's topology. And our squares are our simplest case, but we can have more complicated topologies where we glue together multiple sides and make more complicated shapes with more holes. And there are different topologies that are best fit for flat space or positively curved space or negatively curved space. Now let's go from 2 dimensions to 3 dimensions. And let's replace our square now with a cube, with this side identified with this side identified with the back, and the top with the bottom. This kind of finite, what we call a 3 torus, or a donut or a bagel in 3 dimension, higher dimensions, is something that's actually familiar to people who played computer games, where in some computer games, if the space aliens leave through this wall of your computer game, they reemerge through this wall and come back. And if the universe had a structure of a 3 torus, if you left through here, you'd reappear here. And here's another representation, another way of thinking about the same topology, where I just take identical copies and I glue them together. And you can see the Earth appears in all of the multiple copies, but these are just representing the same picture over and over again, just reminding us that if I leave through this wall up here, I reemerge through the bottom. And that's going to be useful when we think about measuring the topology, to have that way of thinking. And I've shown the tiling associated with flat space and cubes. There's actually an infinite number of different tiling patterns in negatively curved space, each with their own special topology. And it's a very rich area of mathematics to understand all of the possible topologies. And the topologies also work in spherical topology. One of my favorite spherical topologies, because I think we've all seen this, is an orange. If you open, you peel off the orange and look at the orange slices and make each orange slice in your perfect orange, where every orange slice looks identical, copies of themselves, then the universe is a single orange slice and you leave through one and you come back the other way. So that's a tiling of a positively curved space, or orange, in a 3-dimensional positively curved space. And here's one with 120 regular dodecahedrons tiling space. So there's lots of fun topologies here. All right, let's go back now to the microwave background. So remember, when we look at the microwave background, we're looking out at a sphere around us. And here's a sphere centered around one copy of the universe, and this is our 3 torus. Here's another copy with the sphere around it. And you can see the 2 spheres intersect at a circle. That means if I'm an observer, and I look at the microwave sky, I see the same pattern there as I do over there. Because whenever two spheres intersect, I get a circle. That, by the way, is true not just for our cube, but for any of the topologies. And so I can, if I look at the sky at all those spheres, I'll be able to find the shape of the universe. So this is a simulation of one of these cases where we would actually expect many matched circles on the sky. And this circle has one, I think in this case, it's a 3 torus. So on the backside, there's another circle with the identical pattern. And you go and you look for all of these circles and you'll maybe be able to measure the topology. And this again is just showing the multiple copies. And these are spheres, and wherever the spheres intersect, you'll get another circle that you'll see on the sky. And what we looked for, we took this sphere, there it is on the ground, and we drew on this sphere lots and lots of circles, and we compared every possible circle and asked, do we find matches? Now you get some matches randomly. And this blue line represents what happens randomly, because every now and then you'll have patterns that look alike. This is the circle that looks most alike as a function of the radius of the circle. And this bumpy curve shows all the matches. So the way you develop a big computer code for this is you put in simulated data that looks like what you're looking for. And this is what we would expect to see. Now, when we went to look, oops, this went so fast. There it goes. This is what we saw. The red are circles going this way, and the black are the flip version. Blue is what you expect from random. This is the highest amplitude we'd expect at any position, given our simulations, and we see exactly what we'd expect if there was no evidence for a finite universe. So what we learn from this is the universe is big, that the size of the visible universe is basically bigger than the size of this sphere. It's basically at least 30 billion light years across. And the measurements on this have only improved, right? I've mentioned that the Planck satellite has mapped the sky at higher resolution, but it's also made precision measurements, not just of the universe's temperature, but of the pattern of polarization. And they have analyzed those maps and put constraints on the geometry and topology of the universe. And again, this is a more recent paper where they looked and saw in their simulations what you'd expect to see in a finite universe. And here's what the observations look like. Again, reinforcing the evidence that our universe is very big. So what should you take away from this talk? First of all, I think you should have a sense cosmology is in the golden age. In the past 20 years, we have measured the universe's age, shape, the density of atoms, density of matter, the lumpiness of the universe and how it grew to form galaxies. We've measured these things where we know the age of the universe to 1%. We know the density of atoms better than 1%. And we can use this data to answer some really basic questions about the universe's geometry, which seems close to flat, which seems to suggest a future that's going to be really cold. We're not going to collapse in the future in a hot crunch, but expand forever. And we don't know whether the universe is finite or infinite. We just know that it's big and that that scale is bigger than the observed universe. And it could be infinite. It could be if we keep going and we just keep going forever. All we know is that it's not a small universe. And that's been a fun process of discovery and one that I think shows the tremendous connection between our mathematical understanding and our mathematical language and our understanding of the the physical universe. And, you know, this is, to me, just another example of the wonderful idea that Eugene Wigner put forward of the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics. That mathematics is this powerful language for describing the universe. And remarkably, the mathematics that you probably all learned, I don't know, 10, 11, that the sum of the angles in a triangle is 180 degrees, was valid not only in sixth grade, but on the scale of the observable universe. So I'll leave you with that. Thanks.
All right, so we will now open it up to questions. And I have one right here in the live studio audience.
Professor Spergel, thank you for this fascinating talk and congratulations for being the new president of Simons Foundation. Speaking of the foundation, about 2 months ago, Paul Steinhardt gave a talk in the foundation and he advocates the slow contraction cosmology to explain the flatness of the universe. So do you have any opinion about slow contraction versus inflation and the when do you think this issue can be resolved through observations?
So I, you know, both are ideas worthy of study. They're both interesting possibilities. I have an intellectual preference, but this is really just my preference for a universe that where time began at a moment, then expanded through inflation. But I think this is ultimately something we want to determine by observation. And the key observation may turn out to be looking for gravitational waves produced in the first moments of the Big Bang. Now, physicists have detected gravitational waves already from the merger of two black holes, merger of neutron stars, and most recently, the merger of a neutron star and a black hole. Those gravitational waves have wavelengths of a few kilometers. From our point of view, they're small. As a cosmologist, I'm interested in gravitational waves generated in those first moments of expansion. So if inflation were the right theory of cosmology, then the universe underwent a very rapid period of expansion. During that rapid period of expansion, gravitational waves are generated. Those gravitational waves will produce a very distinctive pattern of polarized fluctuations of the microwave star. Polarized, when light scatters, it scatters more in one polarization than another. It's something that we've seen. You go to the beach this weekend, you look out at the sun, light reflecting off the ocean surface. Light tends to reflect more in this polarization, this orientation of the electric field, than in this polarization. So light's polarized, why we put on polarized sunglasses. They block one polarization, let through the rest of the light. The microwave background is also polarized, and I quickly show the polarization measurements from Planck. What we're doing right now is making more accurate polarization measurements, and one of our goals with the Simons Observatory is to measure polarization with higher precision to look for a pattern with a net sense of, a sense of the patterns, one where if you reflect it in the mirror, it changes. So you can imagine you have a pattern that you put in a mirror, it looks the same. If you draw a straight line, you reflect it in the mirror, it still looks like a straight line. You have a pattern that looks like that, you reflect it in the mirror, it looks like that. So we're looking for anti-symmetric patterns that flip in a mirror, and that's what we expect from gravitational waves. If our experiment sees that, that would be further evidence for a model like inflation that would suggest that the universe did begin with an initial singularity and then expanded. On the other hand, if we don't see that, or perhaps see evidence for some of the features that been suggested in some of these bouncing models that Paul Steinhardt and his colleagues have developed, that would be evidence for those alternative models. So these are, I think, did time have a beginning, or is like the universe infinite in time, is a profound question, and one that I think we will ultimately be able to address by observation, I hope.
All right, here's a question from chat. You referred to the torus as the simplest model for a finite universe. Would a sphere of the appropriate dimension be simpler?
Well, a sphere is, depends on one's definition of simplicity. There are actually two simple models. So a sphere is a finite model, and our orange slices is another version of the finite spherical model. So those are two finite universes. The sphere has the property that you can't come, it's a universe that expands and then contracts. It contracts fast enough if it's just a sphere. You don't have time to come around the whole universe if you're traveling at the speed of light. So my favorite finite universes are ones where you can go back and revisit, travel in that direction, come back and revisit yourself, the Earth. It's like the Earth's surface, where many, many years ago, I bought a round the world plane ticket, flew first to California, eventually to Japan, then to India, then to Paris, and then back to New York, and always headed in the same direction. And I like the cubical models because they have that nice, potentially have that nice property.
Hello. So I really enjoyed the talk. Thank you very much. I had a couple questions. First, could you elucidate how exactly general relativity predicts that in a curved space-time or something like a positive curvature, that would predict that at over time the universe would expand and then contract, and then for a negatively curved space-time, it would continue expanding.
So the key idea. Now, to go back to the summary of general relativity has two key ideas, right? So matter tells space how to curve. The more matter, the more positive curvature. So in a positively curved universe, there's a lot of matter. In a low density universe, there's less matter. So gravity's weaker. The expansion of the universe and how it evolves is a struggle between the kinetic energy, the energy in expansion, versus the gravitational energy that's pulling it back and slowing expansion. The more matter, it's positive curvature, the stronger gravity is. So in a positively curved universe, gravity, there's so much matter around that it can overcome the universe's expansion, make it slow, stop, and turn around and collapse. In a negatively curved universe, the density of matter is very low. So self-gravity is relatively unimportant, and the universe, once starting expansion, just keeps expanding forever.
Thank you. My second question is kind of bouncing off of your question about what you said about gravitational waves from the beginning of the universe. If you had to say, are how close are we to potentially discovering those and observing those? Is that something on the horizon?
I hope so, since we're engaged in building a big experiment to look for it, and we're hoping to have results within the next 5 to 10 years. The level of gravitational waves that's predicted in the model depends upon how rapidly the universe was expanding when it was undergoing the processes that produced the large scale of the universe, we call the period of inflation. So it depends on what that energy scale is, how fast it expanded. And that's an unknown. It's a pretty wide range in parameters. We will, over the next 10 years, improve our sensitivities by about a factor of 100. We can see a signal that's 100 times weaker. But it's something where we don't know the intrinsic amplitude. So 100 time improvement is enough that I have hope that we'll see it, but there's no guarantee, and there's there are actually many experiments like this we do in physics where we don't know how sensitive the experiment will have to be before we make a discovery. So this is true for searches for dark matter. It's true for the searches for gravitational waves. It's actually true in many ways for searches for Earth-like planets around other stars. We build bigger and better telescopes. We improve on the past by factors of 10 or 100, but we don't know how far we have to go before the discovery happens. It's part of the adventure.
This may be related to what you just said, a question from chat. What are the physical limits to the data that can be extracted from the cosmic microwave background?
The damn dust. So I was talking about the galaxy and the fact early on that we're observing through this smudgy window. We're in a car, we're looking out the beautiful scene, we've got a smudgy, dirty window. And we can remove some of that dirt, but there's a limit to how much dirt we can remove. And that limit constrains what we can see in gravitational waves. And we can improve things by about a factor of 100, maybe 500 from where we are today. But once we've done that, the signal from the dust in our own galaxy really starts to swamp things and probably represents an astronomical limit on how sensitive those measurements can be.
I want to thank you so much for, on behalf of many thousands of people, for the Simons Foundation continuing support of MoMath. Wonderful, wonderful organization, and really has turned on thousands of kids to the wonders, the joy of mathematics. My question was about dark energy and dark matter. It seems to me that's kind of an obvious thing. And I was a little surprised when I read that some astronomers and other physicists looked at dark matter and dark energy and said, geez, what is that? It seems to me that in the vastness of space, you have an awful lot of, hydrogen and helium and other elements just floating around there, not captured by gravitational pull, to be sparking into a star or anything. So it seems to me it's kind of an obvious thing that they would be there.
So there's a lot of the stuff that makes up stars makes up only about 1% of the density of the universe.
Right.
This gas that you're talking about, the free hydrogen and helium in space, there's a lot of it.
Yeah.
It makes up about the next 4%. So it's significant. And these sort of, sometimes people call them invisible gas because it's harder to detect, though. Well, there are ways we can detect it. In recent years, we've been able to trace it and we can observe its effect on microgravity. Dark matter, which makes up about the next 25% of the universe, is something different from atoms. What we know is, we know what it's not. And it's not protons and electrons. In fact, it's not any kind of particle we've ever made in the laboratory up to now. So we know that enough about dark matter to know that it's something new, but we don't know what that new stuff is. And in the history of physics, we often discovered new things by their absence. And some of my astronomy colleagues are uncomfortable with new ideas and don't like dark matter and don't understand general relativity well, so they want to modify gravity. Now it's worthwhile thinking about it, but I think the idea of dark matter has been incredibly successful. You can put it into an intricate property. The idea that there's energy associated with empty space actually goes back to Einstein's first formulations of general relativity. So the theory can easily absorb that. That said, it was surprising when the data suggested it, because the level of dark energy and its scale does not connect easily with our ideas in particle physics. So from the sort of fundamental physics side, what's exciting about dark matter and dark energy, not only is it most of the universe, it's most of the universe that, and it implies the existence of new physics we haven't seen before. It says that, you know, the quest for physics isn't done, that 21st century, or we hope, 22nd century, there's no guarantee we find it soon, is physics is there to be discovered. And there's some profound things that we don't understand. I mean, another profound piece we don't understand from the cosmology is, why are there more protons than antiprotons? You know, that's not explained by our standard model of physics and requires some new physics. There are lots of experiments. People are trying to search for that new physics. But all of these things that we've talked about, dark matter, dark energy, the asymmetry between protons and antiprotons, gravitational waves, all are actually kind of guarantees that there's new stuff to discover. They're, you know, especially for some of the students here and some of the people watching online, I really want to convey to the students, this is a moment where we know there are great discoveries to be made.
And that, of course, underscores your first point.
Yes, yes.
Okay, my question, it's going to seem simplistic. How is our matter, it matters. All right, how is matter located? May I assume that light will locate it? Is there another type of wave that will also do that, like wave?
This is a great question. So we've traced the distribution of matter in a couple different ways. The simplest one is, if the matter is in the form of atoms and it forms stars, we see the stars. And we trace the distribution of stars, first in our galaxy, and then in other galaxies. So when we look at the large scale structure of the universe, we're seeing how galaxies are distributed. And that's giving us a measurement of how atoms are distributed. We can also measure the distribution of dark matter through gravitational lensing. So let me go back to an early slide. I think it's my second slide. There we go. Matter curves space. And it doesn't matter for the effect of general relativity whether this is a star or a lump of dark matter. By measuring how much light is curved, I can infer the distribution of matter. So one of the most active areas of cosmology right now is we're building actually a series of experiments, a ground-based experiment called the Rubin Observatory, named after Vera Rubin. Europeans are building a mission called Euclid. Both Rubin and Euclid will turn on in around 23. Something that I have helped lead is NASA's building a mission called the Nancy Grace Roman Telescope that will launch in around 2026. And what all of these experiments are doing is they are measuring the shape and distribution of galaxies and the properties of things like supernova explosions to see how light has been bent and curved. And that has the ability to trace the matter distribution without looking for light. So I would say your question is what's driving much of observational astronomy right now is measuring how matter is distributed.
What is the newest, most promising way to measure the curvature of the universe? Are there any specific breakthroughs in the field that you are excited about?
So we continue to improve our measurements by looking at the microwave background and those measurements improving. We're also improving our measurements by looking at the large scale distribution of galaxies. These same sound waves that produce the patterns we see in the microwave sky also show up in the clustering of galaxies and the clustering of gas. And some of these experiments that I've talked about, these observatories, are about to make much more precise measurements of galaxy clustering, which will turn into more precise measurements of the geometry of the universe. And, you know, one thing interesting saying about measuring something close to zero is every now and then there's some exciting report that someone's improved their measurements and it's not zero, it's slightly positive, which would be a positively curved universe, or slightly negative. So far, none of those results have held up, but I'm hoping we get some interesting surprises. You know, in science, it's exciting to see what you expect. It's even more exciting to see what you didn't expect.
All right. If you had to bet, which would be understood first, dark energy or dark matter?
Dark matter.
Okay, next question. Why?
Well, two reasons. We have many plausible theories of dark matter. It's easy to see how various extensions of the physics we know will produce dark matter. And we have many experiments that are actively looking for dark matter in these different forms. So it's very possible that as we speak, someone in some underground experiment, they're often underground, low background, is detecting dark matter right now. So we could, you know, it is possible that a year from now we open the newspaper, although in our modern age, it means our phones buzz. You've got the right alerts. And your phone tells you there's a claim of dark matter detection. So it may take 100 years, but we could in the next year know what dark matter is. On the other hand, I don't think we have much in the way of good theoretical models for understanding dark energy. Understanding the energy associated with empty space requires probably a deeper understanding of the connections between quantum mechanics and general relativity. I think of quantum mechanics and general relativity as the two great ideas of physics, or two of the great ideas of physics of the 20th century. And they both work beautifully in their own realms. The most active area of theoretical physics is how do you combine quantum mechanics and general relativity. String theory, which some of the brightest people I know have been working on now for several decades, seems to be our best hope. But despite their best efforts, we don't have something that comes out of string theory that explains what dark energy is. And so we don't know when that breakthrough will be.
All right. Well, on that note, I think we're going to wrap things up. Let's give a cheer and a thank you to our speaker.